بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة فصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وبعد. Last time we started the topic of the Sahaba, the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and our beliefs regarding them. So I'll continue inshallah. Yeah, you can inshallah. طيب. The Shaykh says about Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, about those who follow the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, his Sunnah and the Sunnah of the rightly guided Khulafa and the early generation of the Muslims. He says, وَيُقِرُّونَ بِمَا تَوَاتَرَ بِهِ النَّقْلُ عَنْ أَمِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ عَلِي بْنَ أَبِي طَالِبٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ وَعَنْ غَيْرِهِ مِنْ أَنَّ خَيْرَ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ بَعْدَ نَبِيِّهَا أَبُو بَكْرٍ ثُمَّ عُمَرٍ وَيُثَلِّثُونَ بِعُثْمَانَ وَيُرَبِّعُونَ بِعَلِيٍّ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ كَمَا دَلَّتْ عَلَيْهِ الْآثَارُ. أهل السنة والجماعة, they also affirm all the reports that have been narrated from Ali radiallahu anhu. And those reports have reached a level of tawatur. What does tawatur mean? Two categories in science of hadith you will learn. Mutawatir and ahad. What is the difference between mutawatir and ahad?
Mutawatir is when all the sahaba.
Yeah.
A certain amount of sahaba have mentioned it.
Such that
it's like a level where it can't be disputed.
Yeah, such that its level can't be disputed. For example, I say something and 10 brothers, they narrate it. Okay, if 10 brothers go out and say, you know, Imam Salim said this in the khutbah, he said this in the khutbah, 10, all 10 of them agree on this, what does it mean? That Imam Salim must have said it. Whereas, if one person comes to you and says, you know, Imam Salim said ABCD, it's quite possible that he forgot. It's quite possible that he got it wrong. Quite possible that he didn't preserve what I said in his memory accurately. There's a possibility of some mistake happening. Okay, human error, not anything deliberate. Not that he's trying to lie. Not that he's trying to make something up. So, likewise, if you get like dozens of people narrating the same thing about one person, that means they can't all get together and conspire to invent a lie against this person. So this event must have happened. This is what tawatur means. Mutawatir. وَيُقِرُّونَ بِمَا تَوَاتَرَ بِهِ النَّقْلُ عَنْ أَمِيرِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. They also affirm the reports that have been narrated from Ali رضي الله عنه himself. And the Shia, obviously, they consider Ali to be the be-all and end-all of their religion. Ali رضي الله عنه. Yet, we are saying that the reports that emanate from Ali رضي الله عنه are mutawatir. Saying what? مِنْ أَنَّ خَيْرَ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ بَعْدَ نَبِيهَا أَبُو بَكْرٍ. That the best person from amongst his ummah after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is who? Abu Bakr. And this is narrated from who? Ali radiallahu anhu. And not just one singularly narrated narration with a bit of speculation. No, it is mutawatir, narrated by so many different people that you cannot deny it, you cannot reject it. Logically speaking, you cannot reject it. But obviously Shiaism has nothing to do with logic, which is why they reject it. So it is narrated from Ali radiallahu anhu that the best person in this ummah after the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is who? Abu Bakr. And then Umar. And then they consider Uthman radiallahu anhu to be the third best. And then Ali radiallahu anhu to be the fourth. كَمَا دَلَّتْ عَلَيْهِ الْأَثَارِ وَكَمَا أَجْمَعَ الصَّحَابَةِ radiallahu anhum عَلَى تَقْدِيمْ عُثْمَان فِي الْبَيْعَةِ. Just as all of the companions, there is ijma', okay? No disagreement amongst the companions. There is ijma' amongst the companions that Uthman is preferred over Ali when it comes to khilafah, when it comes to bay'ah, oaths of allegiance. Sahaba, by agreement, gave oaths of allegiance to Uthman radiallahu anhu. Okay, so there was no dispute over his khilafah. Because one of the contentious issues as far as the Shia are concerned is the khilafah of Uthman. Okay? They say the not only Khilafah Uthman, but also Khilafah of Abu Bakr Umar. They say the Khilafah was null and void because Ali should have been the Khalifa. Rather, we say the Sahaba at the time, they all agreed on the Khilafah of Uthman radiallahu anhu. مع أن بعض أهل السنة كانوا قد اختلفوا في عثمان وعلي رضي الله عنهما. Even though, and this is a fine point you need to understand. Even though أهل السنة at the time disagreed as to who is better than the other, okay, who is more favored than the other, Uthman or Ali. Some of the Salaf said Ali is better than Uthman. Others said Uthman is better than Ali. But this was the only point of contention amongst the companions and the generations after them. There was no disagreement over the fact that the third Khalifa was in fact Uthman, and that his Khilafah was legitimate. Okay? So there's a difference between the two. Okay? Who was the rightly elected Khalifa, the third Khalifa, and who was better than someone else? There are two different issues. So Ahlul Sunnah, even if they disagree as to who is better, Uthman or Ali, they still agreed that Uthman is the rightly guided third Khalifa after Umar radiallahu anhu and before Ali radiallahu anhu. Okay, this much they agreed on. Do you understand the difference? Seem a bit confused. Huh? Yeah, you understand, yeah? So if a person says Uthman has more virtues than Ali, or Ali has more virtues than Uthman, and he's from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, no big deal. But if a person says no, Uthman shouldn't have been the Khalifa, Ali should have been the Khalifa, that is a big deal. You understand? Yeah? You understand now? So as far as the virtues are concerned, Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah disagreed. As far as the Khilafah is concerned, then nobody disagreed that the third rightful Khalifa, the one who deserved the third position in terms of Khilafah, was indeed Uthman radiallahu anhu. And after him, Ali radiallahu anhu. مع أن بعض أهل السنة كانوا قد اختلفوا في عثمان وعلي رضي الله عنهما بعد اتفاقهم على تقديم أبي بكر وعمر أيهما أفضل. So after they had agreed that Abu Bakr is the best, and then Umar, they disagreed regarding Uthman and Ali. فَقَدَّمَ قَوْمٌ Uthman وَسَكَتُوا. Some of the Ahl Sunnah, they give precedence to Uthman. They favored Uthman, and then they remained silent. Others, they added Ali radiallahu anhu as the fourth best companion. So some people said Uthman is the third best, and after that they remained silent. After that they didn't compare between anyone. Okay? Some of the Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they added Ali radiallahu anhu to the list and said, in fact, after Uthman is finished, he's received the third position, Ali is given the fourth position. وَقَدَّمَ قَوْمٌ عَلِيًا. And some people gave preference, from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, some people gave preference to Ali over Uthman. وَقَوْمٌ تَوَقَّفُوا. And other people, they decided not to dictate who is more virtuous than the other. They completely stood out of the debate as to whether Ali is more virtuous than Uthman or Uthman is more virtuous than Ali. They kept out of it altogether. لكن استقر أمر أهل السنة على تقديم عثمان. However, that's the important point to remember, is that أهل السنة والجماعة, in the beginning, they may agree or disagree upon an issue, but over a period of time, they come to an agreement. And once they have come to an agreement, it becomes impermissible for people then to disagree with that. I give you some examples. At the time of the Sahaba, when the Sharia was still being codified, okay, when people were writing all the hadith down and making up the fiqh and for making it, you know, easy for people to understand, at that time, some of the Sahaba had really, really odd opinions. Yeah, one of them, Ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, he was the mufassir of the Quran, who the Prophet ﷺ himself, he made dua for him that Allah gives him the fiqh in religion. He had a strange opinion. He had an opinion that it's permissible to practice mut'ah. What's mut'ah? Marriage? Temporary marriage, what the Shia engage in. Okay, without witnesses, without wali, you go up to a sister and say, I would like to marry you for a day. Okay, and the sister says, okay, let's go to your house and let me be your wife for a day. Okay, and that's it. And then after a day, she's on her own, and you know, there's no inheritance, there's no liability, responsibility, nothing at all. This is called mut'ah, temporary marriage, which used to be practiced before Islam, which was allowed at certain instances during the time of the Prophet ﷺ. But before the Prophet ﷺ passed away, the marriage was considered null and void and was completely forbidden. Right? But even then, some of the companions, they continued to practice it for various reasons. Some of them thought that, some of them, they never heard of the prohibition. It never came to them that the Prophet ﷺ had actually forbidden it before he passed away. Others thought he only allowed it in certain occasions and forbade it in other occasions. They didn't consider it an absolute forbidding. So, Ibn Abbas, despite of being such a great imam that he was, a great sahabi, he had this opinion that mut'a is allowed. Okay? So the people started obviously accusing him of things that what kind of scholar is this who's allowing mut'a. So even at this level, at that level, at the level of the sahaba, people had disagreements. After a while, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, generations later down the line, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah agreed all together that mut'a, marriages are not allowed, they are all forbidden. Okay? So if a person now comes up and says, you know what, Ibn Abbas said such and such, I'm going to follow his opinion. We say to him, he is a deviant. He is a mubtadi' and he's on the borderline of nifaq by picking and choosing whatever opinion he likes to pick and choose to suit his desires. Right? This is the importance of istiqar. When Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they settle on an opinion, it becomes an ijma'. Another example. In the beginning, there was a lot of revolts taking place at the time of the Salaf. Okay? One Sahabi revolting against a ruler here, ruler there. The Salaf revolting against each other. Ibn al-Ash'as, he himself revolted against Hajjaj. And as Al-Zahbi says, many, many righteous people of Kufa, they joined his army to revolt against Al-Hajjaj. So there were many of these sort of internal clashes amongst Muslims. Group of Muslims revolting against the ruler of the time. Okay, it happened many times. However, why did it happen? Because some of the people, some of the Salaf, they believe that it is permissible still for a person to revolt against an oppressive ruler. Okay, even if he's not a kafir, even if he's a Muslim, so long as he's just an oppressive, unjust ruler, it is permissible for you to revolt against him. Some of the Salaf held this opinion. However, as the passage of time, obviously, after a passage of time, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah finally agreed on the principle that, which is obviously supported by the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, like all principles, that a Muslim ruler is not to be revolted against even if he is oppressive, unless we see something clear-cut kufr from him, like replacing Sharia of Allah Azza wa Jalla with man-made laws, as it happens in most countries. Unless we see clear-cut kufr from him, and we have a proof of that from Allah Azza wa Jalla. But this is an example of where there was confusion in the early generations. But later down, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they settled on a particular opinion. So that becomes our opinion. So now, لكن استقر أمر أهل السنة على تقديم عثمان. Now Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah have now even agreed that Uthman is to be given preference over Ali رضي الله عنه. وإن كانت هذه المسألة مسألة عثمان وعلي ليست من الأصول التي يضلل المخالف فيها عند جمهور أهل السنة. Even though, despite of that though, this discussion of who is better, Ali or Uthman, is not one of those matters, one of those fundamental principle matters where Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah will declare each other to be innovators. So if a Muslim Sunni, let's say he's read up a lot on the virtues of Uthman and Ali, and out of his own sincere ijtihad, he believes that Ali is more virtuous than Uthman, and he's not to be labeled an innovator, he's not to be shunned, and so on. Okay? لكن المسألة التي يضلل المخالف فيها هي مسألة الخلافة. Where you can lay blame on people for going wrong is when it comes to the mas'ala of khilafah. When someone says that Ali is more deserving of khilafah than Uthman. And this is what the debate with the Shia is about. Okay? Not just about who is more virtuous than others, but about who deserves khilafah more than others. And this is where Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they all wholeheartedly agree that Uthman deserved khilafah more than Ali radiallahu anhu. Okay? So Uthman was the third khalifa, and then Ali was the fourth. So if someone disagrees on this, then this is the issue on which a person can be called blameworthy and he can be considered an innovator for holding such opinion. وَذَلِكَ إِنَّهُمْ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِإِنَّ الْخَلِيفَةَ بَعْدَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ أَبُو بَكَرَ ثُمَّ عُمَرَ ثُمَّ عُثْمَانَ ثُمَّ عَلِيَ. Because they all Ahl Sunnah believe that the Khalifa after the Prophet ﷺ was Abu Bakr, then Umar, then Uthman, then Ali. وَمَنْ طَعَنَ في خلافة أحد من هؤلاء الأئمة فهو أضل من حمار أهله. And then thereafter, whoever doubts or whoever criticizes the khilafah of any one of these four imams, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, فهو أضل من حمار أهله, then he is more misguided than his own domestic donkey. Okay, this is the expression which many scholars use regarding things that are really stupid or things that are considered completely beyond the scope of sunnah. أضل من حمار أهله, more misguided than his own pet donkey at home. And the Shaykh also says, وَيُحِبُّونَ أَهْلَ بَيْتِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَيَتَوَلَّوْنَهُمْ وَيَحْفَظُونَ فِيهِمْ وَصِيَّةَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ أهل سنة والجماعة, like as they love the companions of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, they also love أهل بيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, the people of the household of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, which includes his wives, which includes his close family, Ali and Fatima, and of course his grandkids, which includes Ja'far, and which includes, and according to other opinion, also includes Abbas and his children. Okay? وَيَتَوَلَّنَهُمْ وَيَحْفَظُونَ فِيهِمْ وَصِيَّةَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ حَيْثُ قَالَ يَوْمَ غَدِيرْخُمْ. They also remember the wasiyah of Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. The wasiyah is the last will of Allah's Messenger which he entrusted the Muslims with. And these are the words which he said at a place called Ghadir Khum on his way back to Medina. And he said, أُذَكِّرُكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِ. I remind you to beware of Allah Azza wa Jal, to be conscious of Allah Azza wa Jal with regards to my household, with regards to the people of my household. أُذَكِّرُكُمُ اللَّهَ فِي أَهْلِ بَيْتِ. I ask you to be mindful of my family in the name of Allah. And he also said, وَقَالَ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَصْطَفَ كِنَانَ مِنْ وَلَدِي إِسْمَعِيلِ. That Allah Azza wa Jal, he chose Kinana tribe from Walad Ismail, from the progeny of Ismail. Who are Ismail? Who are the children of Ismail? The Arabs. Okay? The Arabs are the children of Ismail. And from amongst the Arabs, first of all, amongst the entire mankind, he chose who? He favored who? Bani Ismail. Before that, he had favored who? Bani Israel. Okay? He had chosen them above all other nations. In this instance, Allah Azza wa Jal chose Banu Ismail above all other nations and above all other ethnicities. And then from the Arabs, he chose who? The Kinana, the tribe of Kinana. And from Kinana, he chose Quraysh. And from Quraysh, he chose Banu Hashim. And from Banu Hashim, wastafani min Bani Hashim. And from Banu Hashim, he chose me. Okay? So this shows, this several things it shows, that the Prophet ﷺ was the best out of the Banu Hashim. The Banu Hashim were the best out of who? Quraysh. And the Quraysh were best out of Kinana. And they were the best out of the Arabs. The Arabs were the best out of humanity. Okay? That's why Allah Azza wa Jal, he favored them. And so we also remember that. And because of this, we don't like Shu'ubiyya, it's called. It used to be like this anti-Arabist philosophy that used to exist previously in the Muslim countries, where because of the unjust politics of some of the Arab Muslim rulers, some of the non-Arab people, they felt bitterness in their hearts towards the rulers, and they especially the Persians, they thought that their empire has been ransacked by these Arabs who came from the desert. They have complete disregard for our religion, our values and everything else. And to be honest, an element of that, of this Persian nationalism, became fused with Shiaism, which is why you will find the Shias predominantly, they exist in Persia. Most of the literature is in Persia. Though many of the Shia hadith that they've innovated and attributed to the Prophet ﷺ and Ali radiallahu anhu and many of the later Imams, all these false hadith are basically pointing to the virtues of the Persians. So it was sort of like a Persian response to Arab invasion of that time. This is what Shiaism also represents. But we as Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, we hear the words of the Prophet ﷺ, and we respect all the people, all the different types of people that Allah's Messenger ﷺ asked us to respect. Also, وَيَتَوَلَّوْنَ أَزْوَاجَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ أُمَّهَاتِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. And the allegiance of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah is also to who? The mothers of the believers. وَيُؤْمِنُونَ, who are the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. وَيُؤْمِنُونَ بِأَنَّهُنَّ أَزْوَاجُهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ خُصُوصًا خَلِيجًا. And they also believe that the Ummahat al-Mu'mineen, the mothers of the believers, they are all the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. Okay? And that they will be his wives also in the hereafter in paradise. Why do we emphasize this point? Because the Shia, with the exception of Khadija radiallahu anha, they curse the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially Aisha and Hafsa radiallahu anhuma. Especially Aisha and Hafsa. Why? Aisha being the daughter of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, not only that, she did the blasphemous deed of fighting against Ali radiallahu an in the battle of Jamal. Okay, and obviously, Hafsa being the daughter of Umar radiallahu anhu. And Umar and Abu Bakr, both of them were considered to be enemies of Ali by the Shia. So that's why they curse Aisha radiallahu anha. Some of the Shia, you know, if you tell them about the verse in the Quran, النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنْفُسِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجُهُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ. As Allah says in the Quran, that the Messenger, the Prophet, is closer to the believers than their own selves, and his wives are their mothers. So this is the status the Quran gives to the wives of the Prophet ﷺ as the mothers of the believers. The Shias turn around and say, fair enough, but not every mother is a good mother. Okay? This is how these people, they argue. Like the devil. Right? Imagine if a person were to acknowledge, okay, so-and-so is my mother, but I disrespect her with all my heart. Okay? This person, obviously, there's a reason why they are called mothers of the believers, so that we respect them in that way. Not that we turn around and we curse them. But this is the Shia religion for you. They believe that the Prophet ﷺ was such a gullible person that he couldn't find a genuine person to marry his entire life. Yeah? That any woman he married after Khadija radiallahu anha, they all cheated him. Okay, and that he was cheated by all his companions around him. He was cheated by the most closest of all companions, Abu Bakr and Umar. Completely illogical, insane. This is what the Shia doctrine is all built on. This insanity. Okay, so we believe that they will be the wives of the Prophet ﷺ in paradise, especially Khadija radiallahu anha, who is also the mother of most of the children of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَأَوَّلُ مَنْ آمَنَ بِهِ وَعَضَدَهُ عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِ. That she was the first person, one of the first people who believed in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when everybody rejected faith in him. One of the first peoples who helped the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam right in the early stages of Islam when everybody betrayed him and everybody let him down. وَكَانَ لَهَا مِنْهُ الْمَنْزِلَةَ الْعَالِيَةَ. And obviously the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam respected her very, very highly. And an example of that is when Aisha, once the Prophet ﷺ was mentioning Khadija to Aisha, and it will be his practice to mention Khadija all the time to all of his wives. And Aisha, naturally a very jealous woman. So she said to the Prophet ﷺ that Allah Azza wa Jalla has replaced you with better. Don't worry about it, Allah Azza wa Jalla has replaced you with better. The Prophet ﷺ, when he heard this, he became angry. And he turned around and said that no, Allah has not replaced her with anyone better. Okay? Now she was the one who helped me when everybody turned me down, when everybody betrayed me. She was the one who helped me. So the Prophet ﷺ, and also he said that she was the one through whom Allah Azza wa Jalla granted me so many children, which he didn't grant me through other women. Likewise, was Siddiqatu bint Siddiq radiyallahu anha allati qala fiha an-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wasallam fadlu Aisha 'ala an-nisa ka fadli al-sarid 'ala sa'il al-ta'am. The Prophet ﷺ, he also said about Aisha radiallahu anha that the virtue of Aisha over all other women is like the virtue of Sarid, which is a type of dish. It's like a type of curry with lots of meat, which the Arabs used to eat at that time. It's like thareeb ala sa'ir al-ta'am. It's like the comparison between thareeb and all the rest of the dishes. Meaning thareeb is the best you can find amongst all other dishes. Likewise, Aisha is the best amongst all other women that the Prophet ﷺ was married to. So, we also believe in that. And not only that, وَيَتَبَرَّؤُونَ مِنْ طَرِيقَةِ الرَّوَافِضِ. And likewise, Ahl al-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, they completely detach themselves, they completely set themselves free. In fact, turn in enmity to the tariqah of Rawafid, to the way and the method of the Rawafid, the Shia, those who reject the Sahaba. الَّذِينَ يَبْغُضُونَ الصَّحَابَ يُسُبُّونَهُمْ. Those Rafida who hate the companions and curse them. وَمِنْ طَرِيقَةِ النَّوَاصِبِ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ أَهْلِ الْبَيْتِ بِقَوْلٍ وَعَمَلٍ. And likewise, to balance out the equation, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah also detest the way of the Nawasib. Who are the Nawasib? Huh? The ones who curse Ali radiallahu an, and the ones who curse the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam generally. Nawasib, obviously, they no longer exist. Nawasib existed as a reaction to the Shia. Okay, so on the one hand, you had the Shia saying Ali is the one who's the best of the Ummah, he should be the Khalifa and everything else. And Banu Umayyah, they shouldn't be there, they shouldn't be ruling, and they're wretched, and they're rum drinkers, blah, 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 whatever corruption they used to come up with. And so, as a response to them, the Nawasib came along on the scene. Those people who were really supportive of Banu Umayyah, really supportive of the other Sahaba, Amr ibn As and Muawiyah radiallahu anhuma. They came up and said, no, Muawiyah was selected to be the scribe, the one who would be trusted with what? Writing down the Qur'an, writing down a revelation. Imagine, the Prophet ﷺ entrusted Muawiyah radiallahu an with writing down the revelation. So the one who casts doubt on the intentions of Muawiyah is the one who casts doubt on the selection of the Prophet ﷺ for such a sensitive issue, such as writing the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So, when you have people on this side, on the supporting Muawiyah, when they heard other people saying, you know, that Ali is fighting against Muawiyah, naturally, they, in reaction, they came along and they started cursing Ali radiallahu anh. There will be times at Mimbar, people will stand up and they will start the khutbah. The way we end the khutbah, for instance, by saying, traditionally, one of the reasons why we end the khutbah traditionally by saying that may Allah be pleased with Abu Bakr and Uthman and Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, is because traditionally the khutbahs and the members were used to either make dua for the Sultan or to curse his opponents. So this became a practice. So people in Syria will curse Ali radiallahu anh on the minbar. And people in other masajid in Basra and Kufa and Iraq will stand up on the minbar and curse Muawiyah radiallahu anh, without obviously the permission or authorization from any of the two, Abu Bakr, Ali and Muawiyah. They had nothing to do with it. In fact, they had nothing except love and respect for each other. But it's always the rabble, the riffraff on the ground, who try to, you know, make tension out of these sort of situations. So, ومن طريقة النواصب الذين يؤذون أهل البيت بقول أو عمل ويمسكون عما شجر بين الصحابة. But this is another principle. ويمسكون عما شجر بين الصحابة. Fundamentally, أهل السنة والجماعة do not delve into all the issues that happened among the Sahaba. Okay? Because it is a very dangerous topic to talk about. Because you're talking about people who have been exonerated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The whole generation has been exonerated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you make a slip, if you err towards one of the companions, it's a huge error. And so, a person who wants to safeguard his own religion, and wants to safeguard his own tongue, he should not delve in what? He should not delve in this issue of which Sahabi was right, which Sahabi was wrong, which Sahabi should have done this, and which Sahabi shouldn't have done that. Okay? يُمْسِكُونَ عَمَّا شَجَرَ بَيْنَ الصَّحَابَةِ. They stay away from whatever happened among the Sahaba. وَيَقُولُونَ إن هذه الآثار المروية في مساويهم منها ما هو كذب. So What do we say about all the traditions and all the narrations that have been narrated about Ali and Umar and and Uthman and Abu Bakr and so on? What do Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah do? We say most of these narrations are outright lies and fabrications. Firstly, and really, truly, if you look at all the chains and you look at the rijal, you will find so-and-so, kazab matruk. So-and-so is a fabricator of hadith, he is rejected. So-and-so, he was like a propagator for the Shia, for instance. So he makes up a lot of incidents that supports the case of Ali radiallahu anhu over Muawiyah. So his narrations are also rejected. Most of what is narrated in this fog of war is all lies. Okay, most of it. I'm not saying lies just based on the text of what is reported, but lies, even if you just look at the chain of narration, you can spot out the people and you can accuse the right people of lying. Okay? Also, ويقولون إن هذه الآثار المروية في مساويهم منها ما هو كذب ومنها ما قد زيد فيه أو نقص. Some of the traditions, they might be true, but they're exaggerated a bit. Because remember, a person is narrating. And as it happens amongst ourselves, right? One person narrates something from someone else, but with a slight exaggeration. So by the time it reaches the next person, he thinks, oh my God, I can't believe he said A, B, C, D. Right? Whereas if you were to hear from this brother firsthand, without the exaggeration, then he will be able to understand what is being said. Okay? وَمِنْهَا مَا قَدْ زِيدَ فِيهِ وَنُقِصْ وَغُيِّرَ عَنْ وَجِهِ وَصَحِيحُ مِنْهُ. And as for the traditions that are authentic and authentically narrated from them, that put them in bad light, هُمْ فِيهِ مَعْذُورُونَ. The Sahaba are still excused in those situations. Why? إِمَّا مُجْتَهِدُونَ مُصِيبُونَ وَإِمَّا مُجْتَهِدُونَ مُخْطِئُونَ. Either they practice their own ijtihad and they got it right, or they practice their own ijtihad or they got it wrong. What happens if a person practices sincere ijtihad and gets it wrong? One reward. So something which you might be, criticizing the companions for, Allah is giving them reward for it. Because they are exercising their sincere ijtihad on an issue. وَهُمْ مَعَ ذَلِكَ لَا يَعْتَقِدُونَ أَنَّ كُلَّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنَ الصَّحَابَةِ مَعْصُومٌ عَنْ كَبَارِ الْإِثْمِ وَصَغَائِرِهِ. Likewise, Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah are saying, they don't believe that Sahaba are completely infallible, they can't make mistakes. No, they can make mistakes. They can make major sins and minor sins. بَلْ تَجُوزُ عَلَيْهِمُ الذُّنُوبُ فِي الْجُمْلَةِ وَلَهُمْ فِي السَّوَابِقِ وَلَهُمْ مِنَ السَّوَابِقِ وَالْفَضَائِلِ مَا يُوجِبُ مَغْفِرَةَ مَا يَصْرُ مِنْهُ إِنْ صَبَرَ. However, they have so many good deeds, so many good actions, from taking the rubbish from the people of Makkah and the early stages of Islam, and then leaving their homes and their families and their wealth behind, making hijrah all the way to Medina, and then starting a new life over there, and then even then continuing to fight with their wealth and with themselves at Badr and Uhud, losing their lives, losing their relatives, losing their friends. They have so many good deeds that little bit of mistake here and there, it pales into insignificance. حَتَّى أَنَّهُ يُغْفَرُ لَهُمْ مِنَ السَّيِّئَاتِ مَا لَا يُغْفَرُ لِمَنْ بَعْدَهُمْ. Because some of the سَيِّئَاتِ, some of the evil deeds they may have done, they may be forgiven for them, it may be forgiven for them in particular, what won't be forgiven for people who are to come after them. لِأَنَّ لَهُمْ مِنَ الْحَسَنَاتِ أَلَّتِي تَمْحُو السَّيِّئَاتِ مَا لَيْسَ لِمَنْ بَعْدَهُمْ. Because the magnitude of the good deeds they perform is so great that the people that came after them, their deeds will never ever reach that magnitude. So that sort of magnitude of good deeds help wipe out whatever errors they may have committed. وَقَدْ ثَبَتَ بِقَوْلِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Also the Prophet also said, أَنَّهُ خَيْرُ الْقُرُونَ, that the Sahaba are the best of generations. And also, وَأَنَّ الْمُدَّ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمْ إِذَا تَصَدَّقَ بِهِ كَانَ أَفْضَلٌ مِنْ جَبَلْ أُحُدْ ذَهَبًا مِمَّنْ بَعْدَهُمْ. And likewise, just a handful of what they spend in charity is better than a mountain worth of gold which the later generation spent in charity. Okay? ثُمَّ إِذَا كَانَ قَدْ صَدَّرَ مِنْ أَحَدِهِمْ ذَنْبٌ فَقَدْ تَابَ مِنْهُ أَوْ أَتَى بِحَسَنَاتٍ تَمْحُوهُ. And likewise, if a person committed a sin from amongst them, okay, then it will be obviously wiped away by the good deeds they perform. أو غفر له بفضل سابقته أو بشفاعة محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم الذي هم أحق الناس بشفاعته. And likewise, either is wiped out by the good deeds they perform, or on the day of judgment, the Prophet ﷺ himself will intercede for them, and they are the most deserving of the Prophet's intercession. If the Prophet's intercession is for the people of the Ummah, they are the first ones of this Ummah. Or the way Allah Azza wa Jalla wipe out some of the sins, أُبْتِلِيَ بِبَلَاءٍ فِي الدُّنْيَا كُفِّرَ بِهِ عَنْهُ. Or if a companion, for instance, he has to face a trial, like Uthman radiallahu anhu, he had to face a trial. At the end of that trial, he was killed. He paid for it with his blood. كُفِّرَ بِهِ عَنْهُ. So that trial itself wipes out all his sins. فَإِذَا كَانَ هَذَا فِي الذُّنُوبِ الْمُحَقَّقَةِ. If this principle is applied to sins that have actually happened, فَكَيْفَ بِالْأُمُورِ الَّتِي كَانُوا فِيهَا مُجْتَهِدِينَ. If this is the case with respect to actual sins that no two Muslims disagree on, then how about issues where the Sahaba were just mujtahideen, just practicing their own judgment and not actually committing a sin which is agreed upon. In أَصَابُوا فَلَهُمْ أَجْرَانَ. So if they get it right, they get two rewards. And if they get it wrong, they get one reward only. وَالْخَطَأْ مَغْفُورٌ لَهُمْ. And they've already been forgiven. ثُمَّ الْقَدْرِ الَّذِي يُنْكَرْ مِنْ فِعْلِ بَعْضِهِمْ قَلِيلُ النَّذِرِ مَغْمُورٌ فِي جَانِبِ فَضَائِ الْقَوْمِ حَاسِرِهِمْ. And likewise, the things that they could be put for are very, very, very insignificant in light of their virtues, in light of their good deeds, like Iman in Allah, in His Messenger, in Jihad, in His Way, in Hijrah, and defending Allah's Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, and spreading the right knowledge, and all the righteous actions. وَمَنْ نَظَرَ فِي سِيرَةِ الْقَوْمِ بِعِلْمٍ وَبَصِيرَةٍ وَمَا مَنَّ اللَّهُ بِهِ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ فَضَائِلْ عَلِمَ يَقِينًا أَنَّهُمْ خَيْرُ الْخَلْقِ بَعْدَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. And whoever truly, objectively reads the seerah of the Sahaba, and he sees how Allah Azza wa Jalla has favored them, he knows for sure that they are the best of Allah's creation after the prophets. لَا كَانْ وَلَا يَكُونْ مِثْلَهُمْ. There will be no generation, even if there is Islamic revolution that brings back Khilafah, there will be no generation like the generation of the Sahaba. وَأَنَّهُمْ هُمُ الصَّفْوَى مِنْ قُرُونِ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ الَّتِي هِيَ خَيْرُ الْأُمَمْ وَأَكْرَمُهَا عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. And they are the cream of the Ummah. They are the cream of all generations, the best of all nations, which Allah Azza wa Jalla talked about in the Quran. You are the best nation ever raised for mankind. He's talking, not talking about us. A lot of Muslims say, think kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. He's talking about Muslims. He's talking about the Sahaba in particular. You are, meaning the Sahaba, are the best of all nations ever extracted for mankind. وَهِيَ مَوْجُودَ فِيهَا إِلَى يَوْمُ الْقِيَامِ. And this khayr will obviously remain in that generation. No, sorry, different passage. وَأَكْرَمُهَا عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. And of course, the most beloved and the most honorable in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.